So the whole concept about golden hour, the term baby scares, came about by this terminology about 15 years back. As you all know, neonatal resuscitation is extremely dynamic. Constantly something is going on, and we are in a very complex environment here, trying to provide evidence-based, definitive, systematic, and efficient care in the stabilization area itself. Unlike a person who has injury, which is afflicting his head or something, and has to be transported to another center where active resuscitation is carried out, newborn care in the golden hour happens in the delivery room itself, and just trying to stabilize and provide efficient care with an organized team efforts. But there's a lot of communication and pre-planning which is necessary. So the next 10-12 minutes, I'm going to talk about this mostly. So the newborn in about the early 2000s, there was a lot of sensitization about the golden hour strategy, which is a philosophical approach by Myra Wycroft, which is published in the literatures and seminars. And basically it involves evidence-based protocols and a standardized protocol, trying to collaborate between the team members, trying to effectively manage the baby who's preterm, especially. Now, what are the specific things related to a preterm which we need to look at in the first 1 hour? We are all aware that an extremely preterm baby, because of extreme situations of hypothermia, they can become sick and they have high mortality. We have to look at the temperature of the baby. We have to make sure the energy stores are not depleted. Babies may be hypoglycemic. You have to look at this. Whatever you do at this stage, and if you expose the child to too much oxygen, the chances of chronic lung disease subsequently and retinopathy of prematurity, you all very well know. We also know that the inadequate respiratory efforts of this baby need some respiratory support for this child, and they have an immature respiratory tract. So taking this into consideration, we also realize that these babies have surfactant deficiency, so therefore their lung expansion gets hindered. They need some support for their gas exchange, otherwise they get hypoxic, hypercarbic, and acidotic. They are therefore at high risk of mortality and even morbidity because of that. They have to be also carefully kind of looked after at this time because infection risk is high. So whatever procedures you need to do, you have to be very careful that they don't develop infection. They have very fragile capillaries in the immature brain, which can cause intracranial hemorrhages. You have to be very careful about resuscitating them effectively. They're very, very susceptible to hypovolemia. So all these things make the immature baby very complex at the time of birth. And there are multiple things you need to do. An active team approach is required. You need to prevent hypothermia and also give good benefits. For example, delayed cord clamping. There's a lot of evidence now that if you were to have a baby who's stable, though premature at the time of birth, why don't you try to delay the cord clamping to at least about 30 seconds or 60 seconds to give more benefits to the baby, which is well known. So all this you have to incorporate in this plan of action while you're effectively and gently resuscitating this baby if there's a need. Subsequently, after stabilization, you need to transport this baby to the ICU and give optimal respiratory support and other cares. And all this while, you have to communicate with each other, and you have to also have a good team approach and communicate to the family as to what is happening. So our role in the 1 hour after birth becomes very complex. We have to look after counseling, which may be antenatal counseling. The baby is going to deliver. You have to speak to the family. Let's say it's a 26-weeker. They're concerned about the morbidity and mortality and long-term issues. You have to speak to them. You are having an imminent delivery, and therefore, you have to arrange the equipments. You have to be prepared for all the time. Sometimes preterm deliveries are multiple births because of IVF. You have multiple births, you have triplets and twins, so you need to have good teams. You have to assign the roles. You have to have a team leader who is going to assign the roles. The baby comes out. You have to also enter the delivery room much before the delivery. Try to maintain the temperature. You can have simple devices like warmers, which are now available. Simple warmers can be heating up the environment there. You need to make sure you talk to the obstetrician and the anesthetist, if it's especially a cesarean section, that you need to delay the cord clamping to benefit the baby in the long run. So you have to explain to them, why don't you just wait? If the baby is stable, we'll tell you, you can delay the cord clamping. We may not have to rush into resuscitation if the baby is active. We need to understand that oxygen alone is not right enough, because now we know about oxygen toxicity. So blenders like this need to be incorporated in our labor rooms everywhere, including the operating rooms where the babies are delivered. We don't use ambu bags anymore, and we use therefore respiratory support devices like the steep resuscitator, where you can fix the pressures you can generate so that the baby doesn't have risk of lung injury, both acute and long term. we need to, of course, be very cautious about cardiac compressions or what you call cardiac massage. These are all not really required most of the times, and medication is hardly ever required, except if the child is really very bad, you may need to use some adrenaline or some saline. As per the new ILCOR guidelines, most of these things are not required. We also, therefore, have to parallelly start looking at preventing water losses from the baby while you're resuscitating, especially babies who are less than 1 kilo at birth. You have to make sure you take enough care so that they don't become sick, because any hypothermia can increase their sickness also, and any loss of water can further deprive them and cause problems to them. Now, these are the things which we initially strategize. So any labor room should be always prepared for setting the room temperature. You need to make sure that the temperature is about at least 26 degrees centigrade, the environmental temperature. You have to have a polythene wrap made of some food grade polythene bag so that you can wrap up this baby. So these small shoe covers, which are available in most hospitals now, made of good grade plastic, you can use them to cover the baby. Usually we cut them and cover the baby with that. And also the same thing can be used as a cap for these babies so that some thermal stabilization can occur. We usually use what's called pre-warm thermal mattresses, which are made of phase change material. It's freely available now. Or we can use warmed up blankets, which you can just heat up with the radiant warmer, and then you can keep it under the baby so that baby, when you receive it on the resuscitation table, baby is warm. Or when you receive the baby from the maternate mother, you can keep the baby wrapped up. You can also monitor the baby's temperature in the delivery room using, of course, nowadays standard thermistors are available connected to the radiant warmers, but you can have the room temperature monitor here all the time, simply hanging next to the baby's cot there, so that you know that the temperature around the baby is around at least 26 degrees centigrade. Once the baby is delivered, you can even transport the baby to the NICU in the same hospital if it is so, or if you're going to transport the baby to another hospital, you need to wrap up the baby in some occlusive wraps. You can use pre-warmed cotton bales. You can use many of these food grade polythene bags which are now available. So this is something we need to sensitize. Even when you're resuscitating a baby, you need to be sensitive about the temperature. The babies can easily lose temperature, and 1 degree loss of temperature can increase the morbidity and mortality by as much as 28%. That is recent data. So that is why temperature in the golden hour is very important, and we need to re-emphasize about it. Now, I was talking to you about delayed cord clamping. Why it's important is, these are the good things which can happen. If you delay the cord clamping by 30 to 60 seconds, provided the baby is stable and the baby comes out crying, yes, we need to support the transition from a fetal to newborn circulation, closely watching the baby. But you can tell the obstetrician not to panic. You can also tell the residents not to panic. Stable, the baby has got some respiratory effort. You don't think there's any, the heart rate is good. And oxygenation, you can even treat a preductal saturation monitor for that baby, and saturations are building up. You need to rush into trying to cut the cord, about 30 seconds at least. So it improves the circulating blood volume for the child. Subsequent need for transfusions come down. Blood pressures are better, reduced need for inotropic support. But look at this, meta-analysis has showed there's a lesser risk of intracranial hemorrhage and necrotizing enterocolitis. So as a result, if you are able to delay the cord clamping, the baby is stable, that would be very appropriate. But nevertheless, suppose therefore this baby delivers preterm, is vigorous, does not require much active scene. So concentrate on the temperature, keep the baby under the warmer. Umbilical cord can be cut, delayed a bit for at least 30 seconds. And you will see that the baby can be stabilized. Now, in a sick child who is not breathing well, but he's spontaneously breathing, but you find that a saturation probe, you would then take some effort. You can put the saturation probe in the preductal finger here and try to look at the target saturations. The target saturations, you still have time. If you see the target saturations published by Dawson here, you'll find that the oxygen saturation targets for you can be easily up to 5 minutes. You expect only at 5 minutes about 80 to 85% saturation. So initially, if you see the first 1 minute, you can expect lower saturations in the preduct. So what you can do is monitor the baby's heart rate, as well as if you have a monitor, that's fine, or with a stethoscope. And if you find that the baby's work of breathing is increasing, then of course you need to use a T-piece resuscitator. We call it a positive pressure respirator. We put a mask as possible and just give positive pressure. These are the ILCOR guidelines, which are published long back in 2014. But the new ILCOR guidelines also in 2020 say nothing much is different. These are the target saturations which are now available. You would use a blended oxygen plus air. You don't start with 100% oxygen at all in preterm newborns. You would start with probably 21% and build it up. So the saturations are decreasing. You can keep building it up 30%, or you can downgrade from 30% backwards. On the contrary, if the child has got a prolonged apnea, saturations are falling, heart rate is falling, you would need to intubate these babies. And subsequently, if the heart rates are still not improving, that's the ILCOR guidelines and NRP shows you that you need to probably ventilate these babies. But what I wanted to sensitize was, all this happens in the first 1 or 2 minutes, and you already decide, but if the child has got a good spontaneous breathing, you would probably not ventilate the baby. Just CPAP or positive pressure mask ventilation is more than enough, and you can use a T-piece device. You can set the pressures, let's say 16 bar 5, 16 centimeters of H2 is the higher limit and 5 is the lower limit, which is a peak, and then you can give just with a finger, you can keep giving positive pressure beds, and the child usually picks up. Most of the times these things are more than enough. But then if the child needs chest compressions, what you call cardiac massage, the child is really poor, at 15 minutes also the Apgar is less than 2, then the chances of disability and mortality are high, and that is the time when you need to sit with the family and discuss with them whether it is necessary to continue the resuscitation or not, or what do they want to do. Especially if the gestations are less than 26 weeks, most of the times it becomes necessary to talk to the family about the future aspects and the aggression of care which is needed by them or not. Now, when this baby has been resuscitated and the next few minutes baby is still in the labor ward, you need to look for any developing respiratory distress. Yes, many babies, especially if they are gestationally less than 32 weeks, would have tachypnea, nasal flaring, grunting, intercostal, subcostals, and maybe apnea and cyanosis, and your saturations are not enough. You may need still to continue the positive pressure respiratory. But then you can't leave the baby alone here. You have to ask your resident, or you may have to ask some good nurse to probably keep on monitoring this baby so that the child is closely observed and nothing goes wrong with the child. So this child is slowly either going to get worse because this lung compliance is going to get worse because surfactant is deficient, and therefore his bulk of breathing is going to increase. Or if it is just water in the lungs, like say there's a late preterm baby who's just 35 weeks of gestation, there's a lot of transient tachypnea of newborn in the lungs because of water, he starts getting better. So the next 3 to 4 hours determines what is the course of this baby, and this baby needs to be monitored. We usually use what is called a transition nursery approach. We keep the baby in a transition area like that and keep a pulse oximeter on the baby always on the right foot, right hand, called the preductal, and then keep on monitoring. Some resident is monitoring. You would possibly give this positive pressure breath to the baby. This is a CPAP we are giving. But if we, you see the knob on top, the right knob, if you keep pressing it with your finger, that will give you breaths, positive pressure breaths also to this baby. So this baby is closely monitored, and we have lots of respiratory distress charting scorings available now. You have the Silverman-Anderson score, which is available. You can tell your nurses and doctors to monitor. If the score is getting worse, you know that this baby needs subsequent care in the nursery. Even in late preterm babies or early term babies, for example, this data which we published a few years back, we found that in gestations about 34 weeks and even up to 38 weeks, we would find that 25% of the times babies have respiratory distress and need NICU care. So you cannot leave these babies alone. On the other hand, if the baby is getting better in 2 to 3 hours and the distress is better, you can probably think it was transient tachypnea and can shift the baby to the mother. But if the symptoms are getting worse in the next 1 or 2 hours, you would need to think that it's probably respiratory distress syndrome or hyaline membrane disease. Even in late preterm babies and early term babies, for gestationally about 37 weeks but less than 39 weeks, you would need to be very careful, and these babies need some kind of respiratory support in the nursery. Now, what happens is, once the babies have required resuscitation and delivery room CPAP you can use and stabilized, there are other ways to also look at treatments for these babies in the delivery room. High flow nasal cannula can be also tried. A lot of institutions are trying this, but it is inferior to giving CPAP. CPAP is much better, but nevertheless, if the babies are more than 34 weeks of gestation, high flow nasal cannula may work in the acute situation, easier to use. The other thing is sustained inflation. People thought for a long time, if you were to keep a mask, sustain it for 30 seconds, maybe that lung will get better and the child will feel better. But most of the trials have suggested it should not be done. It causes pneumothorax at birth, so you have to be very careful. Gentle positive pressure breaths are good enough. So you put a mask, gently give positive pressure breaths for some time. If the baby's respiratory drive improves, then you can stop that and just give CPAP. Of course, you have to make sure it's heated, humidified oxygen or gas you're using, and the child usually settles down. Parallelly, if the child is stabilized, then you can probably, and or the child is coming out well and active, you can delay the umbilical cord. But then if the baby needs active resuscitation, for example, the child is born bradycardic, apneic, there is no question. You automatically tell the obstetrician, no need for delayed cord clamping. You need to take the baby out to the resuscitation area and do that. Then the babies who have FiO2s more than 30% and they have still need for CPAP, and your blender oxygen is saying that you need to give 30% and above, and gestations are especially less than 32 weeks, you need to think of giving early surfactant. And this is the indication for giving surfactant, and sometimes you need to redose and give second dose of surfactant also. This surfactant, you can give it in the nursery, but try to give it within the first 2 hours. Ideal would be within 1 hour. The earlier you give surfactant into the baby's lung, whose FiO2 requirements is more than 30% on CPAP or positive pressure breaths, the baby does better later. So in the years, we have been very fortunate. Last 60 years, neonatology has grown by leaps and bounds. The early 90s is when we all started doing neonatology. So about 30 years since I have been having fortune to work in neonatology. We have seen the growth of neonatology, including early surfactants and respiratory care. But all of us had agreed that what is really working now is CPAP. Right at birth, if you do non-invasive CPAP, children are much better. Of course, recently we have started doing a lot of high flow nasal cannula also, but most of the data says that as a primary respiratory support, initially at the time of delivery, CPAP is much better than using high flow nasal cannula. You can see the ventilators in most NICUs like ours, we've got 16 ventilators at one time, they're all working all the time. We don't use ventilation anymore now. We're all convinced that we have to be gentle on the baby's lungs. We do most of the times CPAP or non-invasive ventilation. We would ventilate now babies only if there's severe congenital diaphragmatic hernias, meconiums, or peak PHN, or airway problems, or of course, very rarely in respiratory distress, we would. Most of the times, our ventilators are lying ideal. Even if we were to ventilate, we would be very careful about pressure, and we'll also be very sensitive to volute trauma. So we use what's called volume guarantee ventilation now, and we would not do the earlier type of pressure-limited ventilations anymore. We recently published this last year, the NNF guidelines, what you call the clinical practice guidelines, and I had the fortune of being in the writing group as a reviewer. We are all convinced that non-invasive respiratory support is what is the first line of treatment. There's a strong evidence right from the birth, you do non-invasive CPAP, non-invasive ventilation, even if the baby comes to the nursery, this is the care which we would give to the babies. So what are the modalities with which we monitor now this in the golden hour? Try to get an X-ray chest as soon as possible. Portable is now available everywhere. Now, if you find an X-ray like this with a grade 4 RDS, white out lungs, maybe it's going to get worse. So you would probably think of giving early surfactant. Mild transient tachypnea of the mu bond, you can see some fluid in the interlobar fissure, you know this baby may get better. So we just need to support the baby next 24 hours, maybe the child will get better. Pneumonias, meconiums. So these are things which you can easily make out with X-rays. But then X-rays are difficult to get. So therefore, the next step all of us now are using in the nursery itself is lung ultrasound. You see this lung ultrasound, this is very such a simple technique all of us are doing now. This shows that there's a lot of water in the lungs. This shows that there's probably pneumothorax. So right at the bedside, you can do lung ultrasounds. Apart from doing the standard of care, which is blood gases. Blood gases were all mostly invasive, and we know we can do arterial blood gases, the golden standard. But we also know with good pulse oximeter in the preductal, and there's a difference of preductal and postductal, you can find out how much is the right to left this shunting in the lung. You know, what is the component of oxygenation which is happening. All these point of care assessments are now available. They're also available non-invasively. For example, last year we have published this data, which is non-invasive oxygen saturation index with a good pulse oximeter. You can calculate the oxygenation saturation index, and we find that it is comparable to the oxygenation index. So if you have a level 2 setup or even a level 3 setup, you don't want to keep putting arterial lines or pricking the baby, you can probably use this. And also you can use non-invasive techniques like capillary blood gas analysis. A good arterialized capillary blood gas analysis can tell you a good value about the pH, and it will also show you good carbon dioxide assessments in the baby. These are the new point of care assessments which we now use, and the first golden hour, it really helps us. Lung ultrasound is followed by functional echo, and most of us have now realized how to do good bedside echo, and we can assess the cardiac functions, especially in relation to the contractility of the heart, the ductus arteriosus, and the fluid status in the IVC, and it gives a good idea for us how to monitor the fluid status in the child. So the next thing is surfactant. Most of us earlier days, in fact, we were fortunate enough to publish the first work on surfactant from our unit in the early 90s. We have been using surfactants, all kinds of surfactants, but recently, in the last 5 years, I must say, most of us are using only non-invasive surfactant techniques like the LISA, which is called less invasive surfactant, and is found much superior to even what's called the Ensure technique. So if the child is on FiO2s more than 30%, in the first couple of hours after birth, we would need to give surfactant, and redosing is required if the FiO2 keeps increasing or the RDS keeps worsening. Surfactant preparations, most of the data suggests that bovine surfactant is better than the bovine surfactant. So surfactant is now a standard of care. So ideal would be the golden hour after stabilization at birth, transferring the baby to the NICU, and then giving surfactant. If you do this and start some nutrition and take care of the other things, you've done most of the things. So just to recap, what happens in an extremely preterm baby is going to deliver less than 28 weeks. Registrars are called. We inquire about antenatal steroids. If not given, we request the obstetrician to give at least one dose, if not two doses, and delay as possible with tocolytics. Magnesium sulfate helps the baby's neurodevelopment. See if the obstetrician can give it if the gestation is less than 30 weeks, especially. Ask for history of fever, leaking, chorioamnionitis, antepartum hemorrhage can cause more chances of problems in the baby. So you need to be prepared. So the team needs to allocate itself, perform equipment check, preheat the warmer, incubator, arrange the poly wrap, set the room temperature to 26 degrees, and keep a transport incubator ready to ship to the nursery, whether it's inside the same hospital or another hospital. Obstetricians request them to gently handle when they're delivering the baby, avoid deep suctioning of the mouth or nose, delayed cord clamping. As I said, if the child is vigorous and comes out crying, you can delay the cord clamping. Arrange a T-piece resuscitator for positive pressure ventilation. Don't use an ambu bag. Set the PIP and the PIP so that you know that you're not going to injure the baby's lungs. Keep an oxygen air blender. And if the child is very limp or kind of apneic or gasping, maybe there, straight away you can start the positive pressure respirator like this. But of course, if the child is absolutely apneic, you need to intubate. And try to maintain the preductal saturations in the targets shown. So this is how you would approach the initial resuscitation. And as you can see, this baby is just delivered. And you can see we are giving positive pressure respirator and with just a mask. And it's delivering the set pressures as per the T-piece device there. And you can increase or decrease the respiratory oxygen need according to the blender. You can decide that. And you wait for 5 minutes, 10 minutes. If the baby stabilizes, you can remove this. If not, then we'd probably need to shift the baby to the nursery. So this baby then is needing to be cared for in the nursery. So we have a transport incubator. This baby can be shifted inside the hospital itself, monitored closely with saturations and heart rate in a preheated incubator. And of course, during the transport also, we'd continue the CPAP to the baby with a blender. This is what is imperative to be done. And you can use a mask or a nasal prong to do that. Of course, if the baby needs severe respiratory distress is there, maximal supports of more than 7 centimeters, CPAP is there, and FiO2 is more than 60%, or the child has got prolonged apnea, you would need to probably intubate this baby and then transport, or you can transport and then intubate this baby. So typically what happens when we give CPAP is we want respiratory distress to settle down, the grunting to settle down, the oxygenation to improve, the FiO2 to come down gradually to less than 30%, to find that the child's blood gases are getting better, there's no acidosis, and X-ray also shows relatively improvement in the rib spaces, more than 7 to 8 ribs you can see expanded. You need to do surfactant again to recap if the FiO2 is more than 30% to maintain the saturation. different techniques are there. Earlier days, we have to intubate and keep the baby intubated, giving surfactant. The next step in the mid-2000s, it started was Ensure technique. All of you, I'm sure, are aware of that. You intubate, give surfactant, and after a couple of hours or even less than that, maybe within 20 minutes also, if the lungs are looking better, the child is looking better, you would extubate and put the baby back on CPAP. The technique which we all do now is called the LISA, less invasive surfactant. We use a catheter, a specific catheter is available for this, or you can use any angiocath, or sometimes you use a simple Rompson catheter. This is how we would give surfactant. Nowadays, we would directly see endotracheally the trachea, and with a small catheter inserted into the baby's CPAP is still continuing, we'd insert the catheter filled with surfactant and slowly instill it into the baby's lungs, and 100 to 200 mg per kilo is given over 30-60 seconds while the baby is spontaneously breathing, and we find the surfactant usually distributes well into the baby's lungs, and subsequently the child remove the catheter and then monitor the baby. Most surfactant care is like earlier days, we would make to, we'll need to reduce the ventilation if required, and probably if the baby still needs ventilation subsequent to that, we prefer volume guarantee ventilation as far as possible, and we'll continue caffeine. Before giving the LISA technique, we'll probably pre-medicate the baby with some caffeine IV, and then preferably give a little atropine, which keeps the baby calm, and a little sedation sometimes we give, or we try to avoid narcotics, or otherwise sucrose analgesia is sometimes what we give with some mouth, through the mouth orally. So this is how, if you now look at the extremely small babies, what I discussed just now, you have moderately premature babies who are 28 to 33 weeks. They're spontaneously breathing and they seem to be coming out in a better condition. You see whether their work of breathing is increasing. Yes, if the work of breathing is increasing, then you need to shift this baby into the NICU. Before that, you can start CPAP and the child can be monitored in the NICU. In the NICU, if the FiO2 requirements are more than 30% and increasing work of breathing, you would need to give surfactant. Ideal would be the LISA technique and then closely monitor the child. If the FiO2 is increasing, then you would need to give second dose of surfactant about 4 to 6 hours later. But on the other hand, the child is getting better, or if there is work of breathing increasing but FiO2 is not much, you keep the baby monitored in the NICU, especially if the gestation is 28 to 32 weeks. Babies sometimes require intubation at birth, and then if that kind of a baby comes to the NICU, we try to, and you definitely know that is a respiratory distress syndrome, RDS, you would probably need to give surfactant straight away. You don't have to wait for 2-3 hours, or you don't have to wait for the FiO2 to increase. And then of course this baby can be redosed on surfactant based on the FiO2 requirements. So this is the kind of flow chart which we try to plan for babies who are gestations of more than moderately preterm, more than 28 and 34, less than 33 weeks. The late preterm babies also can get respiratory distress, as we are seeing more and more of these kind of babies. You would need to start again these babies on FiO2's blended oxygen, maybe 21 to 30% in the delivery room. You would start CPAP and then monitor. If the baby, CPAP you see now has become the ubiquitous treatment for all these babies, right from extreme preterms to late preterms. If the baby's respiratory distress settles, which may happen in 4 to 6 hours because the baby may be just having water in the lungs, that baby can be then shifted to the mother if the baby is fine. On the other hand, if the baby gets worse, you will have to see with an X-ray or lung ultrasound whether it is RDS or pneumonia or TTNB, or maybe surgical problem. Sometimes you may be missing a congenital diaphragmatic hernia, so you may have to do an X-ray to even rule out spontaneous pneumothorax. Then we can closely monitor these babies subsequently, and the respiratory care subsequently depends on what you come up with. The other basic stabilization in the NICU once a baby comes is, apart from respiratory support, is IV fluids for nutrition, prevent hypoglycemia. The smaller babies who are less than 1.2 kilo, we would start also parenteral nutrition with a PIC line. We'd start proteins and lipids. We'd insert lines like IV lines and umbilical catheters also to monitor the baby is really sick, and antibiotics to cover some infections, and we'll take all other precautions. So if you see now the overall summary, if I say all the care in the golden hour has been now shifted to non-invasive to keep the lungs open, to recruit lung, to improve the FRC or the functional residual capacity of the baby. Most of it is done through NIV, that is non-invasive ventilation or CPAP. You can give early surfactant and then monitor these babies
Sustained lung inflation is out of the scene, but most of the times it's now early respiratory care with non-invasive ventilation. So to summarize, most of the times you are just giving oxygen suppression or respiratory support, non-invasive, as I said, NIPP or CPAP, or mechanical ventilation is only volume targeted, high frequency at times. So this is the kind of support. The other general supports is to make sure you give caffeine also. There's a lot of data that caffeine not only improves the work of breathing, it reduces the incidence of chronic lung disease and better neurodevelopmental outcome. Now, data is there that even at 12 years of age, these children are better performing to give caffeine at the time of birth to these preterms. Early nutrition is important. Parental nutrition if the baby is very small, the proteins and lipids, antibiotics, and temperature control is very important. And the other thing which we all know about is kangaroo care. Once the baby is stabilized, in our NICU, for example, even if a child is on ventilator, we do probably kangaroo care for the mother, for the baby, maybe within 24 hours. So if you were to again summarize, respiratory support in the golden hour, temperature maintenance in the golden hour, infection control. So every procedure you do, you have to be very careful that you're hand washed, sterilized, and all our team members are sensitive to the fact that even in the put IV lines, be careful because it may lead to infection. So this is something we have to be careful about. Early nutrition is also important. So the whole concept is all about working together in a systematic way in this golden hour. Every team member should know what their roles are. Try to standardize as many things as possible. All these protocols are evidence-based, checklists, and more we are learning that simulation is important. So all the time, our nurses and doctors in the NICUs like us are learning all the time how to do things, why to do things, what to do things, and since physical patients sometimes are not there, we're trying to simulate all these situations. So as I said earlier again and again, all of it depends on a hardcore teamwork. Even in COVID times now, you can see our COVID NICU team here. We have a COVID neonatal team and a non-COVID team. We are all geared now to look after these babies more effectively as a teamwork. So I must stop here, and I really thank our learned audience